As the new elected chair of this committee, let me declare this meeting open. I would like to welcome all participants, members of the Assembly, experts, and external guests. I believe all know the origin of this debate, the adoption of the Resolution 1952 and Recommendation 2023 of the Parliamentary Assembly on the 1st of October of last year, which provoked a controversial debate concerning the circumcision of young boys undertaken. State two facts. First, as many of its texts show, the Parliamentary Assembly is strongly attached to religious freedom. Second, Resolution 1952 on children's rights to physical integrity does not call or suggest. I am sorry for French translation. Let's see what's the problem. Can you help me with this? Is there French translation now? Not yet. Okay, let's wait a minute. What? C'est bon. Okay, so we can continue. Well, before moving to procedural matters, let me state two facts. First, as many of its texts show, the Parliamentary Assembly is strongly attached to freedom of religion. Second, Resolution 1952 on children's rights to physical integrity does not call or suggest to make another statement for the sake of precision and to give justice to the text formally adopted by the Assembly last October. In the film, there is, in the last documentary film, there is a mention of the Assembly resolution referring to circumcision as something illegal and dangerous. Both notions, illegal and dangerous, do not appear in the Assembly text of medical, sanitary, and other conditions to be ensured. See paragraph 7.5.2 of Resolution 1952. So the aim of today's meeting is to support the interdisciplinary debate which has been called for by the text of the Assembly itself and to give the floor to some of those who wish to express their views in public. I apologize in advance for the fact that our meeting time is very limited and invite all participants, both Assembly members, invited guests and members of the audience to remain very brief in their statements. To be as transparent and as equitable as possible, the debate will be structured in the following manner. After the statement by the former rapporteur and the presentation by invited experts, the members of the Parliamentary Assembly will be given the floor first, followed by external guests wishing to speak. Speaking times will be strictly limited. Our experts on the panel are invited to present their views in 5 minutes, if possible, and will be definitely stopped after 8 minutes. All other participants will be allowed to speak for 2 minutes maximum. They will also be stopped if they exceed this time. We will ring the bell every time. Or any person wishing to take the floor, including members of the Assembly and external guests, are asked to register as a speaker via the form that was distributed at the entrance. Green form for PASE members, white form for other participants. And to hand in the form to the presidential table where one person will take note of interested speakers. Please understand that we may not be able to give the floor to all persons having expressed an interest, will try to draw up a list of speakers which is as balanced as possible. I also invite everyone to remain calm and respectful. I recall the rules of the Assembly, providing protection against attacks of a person's honor and reputation. This room. So it's my honor now to give the floor to the former rapporteur, Ms. Ruprecht from Germany. Ms. Ruprecht, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues. Now we are debating as the first step for a resolution of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, the question of physical integrity of children, because the Council of Europe is the institution which deals with the maintaining and the respecting of human rights. It does every effort to protect them, and it is responsible for it. Children's rights are human rights, and this is why the Council of Europe has to protect children's rights. And one elemental right, one basic right from the UN Children's Rights, but also the Human Rights Convention of the Council of Europe, is physical integrity of a human being. A human being begins not just when it is grown up, and this is why the Council of Europe must see what happens to our children, the children who are not able to express their own views, and who therefore are obliged to allow their parents to bring them up. These parents bring them up to go into society, and we have to decide where the rights of the parents and where the right of the child as a in fact does not only cover outside intervention, but also medical intervention, insofar as medical intervention might durably change the body of the child. And that's why the Council of Europe decided that we do not have the right, and it did not listed the fact about genital mutilation of young girls and also circumcision for young boys, just as well as operations for children who come into the world where their gender is not quite clear, for intersexual children. But this also applies to cosmetic operations as well, or other cosmetic intervention, such as to beautify the physique, or also hormonal procedures which might curb or otherwise growth, and which may be thought to be in the child's best interests. The Council of Europe has spent the last 18 months discussing this and listening to experts in this matter. Now, the conclusion is very moderate, and it is formulated in very careful language, because no country is called upon to establish legislation whereby people cannot undermine the interests of children. But this is why we think it's important to have a dialogue with all sectors of society. And today, which is this question of circumcision. The Council of Europe is entitled to continue with this because other subjects are also being discussed too, and countries will be asked as well to deal with these objects. Now, I do hope that today it is clear that the Council of Europe is coming at this from the viewpoint of the rights of the child, and only from this viewpoint. It feels that it is compelled to intervene because the UN Convention talking about physical integrity, and this is something which is enshrined in law, and no other procedures should be entitled to undermine this. All these laws are on an equal footing. This is why the Council of Europe has been called upon to intervene, and this is why this resolution was passed with a large majority. And so I hope that this will be welcomed by many of us, and I hope that we will be able to open dialogue on this subject today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Ruprecht. And I would now turn to our experts, whose names and functions you will also find in our program. May I suggest that we listen to all of them first, and that any questions to our guests be put to them after the round of presentations. Gentlemen, you are all aware that our time is very limited, as I already mentioned, so may I once again invite you to keep to your key messages and rather make use of some of your speaking time to respond to questions from the audience later on. So I would like now to give the floor to Professor Bernard Lobel, urologist and professor at the Faculty of Medicine, former head of department at the University Hospital Center of Rennes, member of the French Academy of Surgeons, representing the Jewish community. Professor Lobel, you have the floor.
Monsieur le Président.
I came here believing that I was going to go to an academic type meeting where arguments would be put forward on the one hand in favor of circumcision and on the other hand against. But I see that in fact it's something different. It really seems to be an anti-circumcision propaganda session. Now, why do I say that? Because we had a 40-minute documentary film totally against circumcision. And I'll take a moment or two to say something about that. Secondly, because I know the two people who are very well known in the anti-circumcision camp are going to speak at the end of our discussion. Great deal of their time, so that's why I say what I have said. Coming back to circumcision, this has been something that has been discussed many times in the course of history, and I would remind you that in the era of the Soviet Union, there was a policy stating that there should be no religious denominations whatsoever, and therefore, in fact, there was a campaign against circumcision, whereas the Nazis felt it was a very good distinguishing feature to have people who had been circumcised, and they were quite in favor of it. Now, we hear a lot about the problems children have today, undernourishment, problems of suffering from violence and wars and in refugee camps. We hear all of these problems. We know that these problems exist, and it seems to me a bit surreal to be talking about circumcision in that context. Coming back to the films. Now, as a surgeon, I can tell you that circumcision is something I'm very familiar with. And when we want to teach young surgeons what they have to do, then we want to tell them how to overcome difficulties they might encounter. So we bring them all together. And then we show you all the things that can go wrong with an operation. And the only difference between our approach and the approach of the film is that we tend to try to be a little lighthearted when we speak to our students. Now, coming back to Madame Ruprecht's report, I know that she had her report on the right of children to physical integrity, and I noticed that she estimates there that 30% of males in the world are circumcised. Do we really believe, then, that if we are to drive all of that underground as a result of some kind of text approved here by this assembly, we're going to somehow improve the quality of circumcision? We're going to make the practice better? I really don't think so. And the real debate we're having today is a confrontation. On the one hand, we have the fundamental right of well-informed parents to make a judgment as to what they believe to be in their children's best interest. And all of this is based on freedom of religion, as recognized in Article 9 of the European Convention, and indeed as upheld by our president here. Yes, we know there are some problems with circumcision. There are some disadvantages. We've heard a lot about them, but we know that they're there. They are recognized as such by WHO and by UNAIDS. And they have stated that when it comes to hygiene, for instance, that things are rather different. Now, I can tell you, I've been seeing 1,000 penises a year for 40 years because I'm a urologist, and I can tell you that hygiene in that area is not the best way of judging health, and that would apply, in fact, to all classes of society where hygiene in that particular area is not always perfectly respected. Now, when you have children who have problems in that area, who have malformation, then, in fact, circumcision can reduce the risk of a urinary infection by ninefold. Further, when it comes to AIDS, we have seen that, in fact, you can bring about a reduction of 50-60% in terms of transmission rates, whereas transmission of AIDS between sexual partners also can fall by 30% if one of the partners has been circumcised. And therefore, when talking about protection against penile cancer, again, we know cancer of the penis is something that people talk about a lot, but we also know it doesn't really exist. There is no such thing as cancer of the penis. And I can tell you that I have only seen cancer in people who have very poor hygiene indeed in that area. So I really think that you cannot say that this is a serious public health issue. Circumcision is not mutilation. Why do I say that? Because, in fact, when you're looking at the prepuce, you know what it is, and you can describe it however you like, but it is neither a sexual organ nor some kind of erectile functioning organ either. It is something that, when it is removed, does not mutilate the person. I certainly have never felt I was mutilating anyone when I was circumcising them. Now, if you're actually going to cut into the member in the light, in some kind of effort to remove the danger of cancer in that area, then that is a mutilation. And sometimes, in fact, removing someone's breast can be an appropriate thing to do. It can be, certainly earlier in my career, I removed a lot of breasts in the interest of saving people from breast cancer. And again, that was, strictly speaking, a mutilation, but it was in the interests of the people concerned. You also have some men who have very, very small penises, very, very small indeed. And so sometimes, in fact, you have to proceed to some kind of aesthetic surgery for that reason. But certainly, even if you remove the very small penis and then you create something in its place, there is no feeling of being mutilated. It's not a question of being mutilated at all. That is not the feeling. And so what happens is that you can actually manage to reconstruct a male penis in a way that allows a man to enjoy exquisite sexual pleasure, which, of course, does require a penis. Now, it seems to me that a lot of things are being put together in the same basket here. And people are mixing a lot of things up. And they're saying that if you have circumcision for religious reasons, it's mutilation. If it's for medical reasons, it's not a mutilization. It's not mutilation. Now, it was Albert Camus who said that mixing things up does not help people. And yes, if you're having to cut off someone's arm or leg, whether or not it's for medical reasons, it is mutilation, as strictly understood. So circumcision does not hinder sexuality. And recently in the Journal of Sexual Medicine, there was an article which gave a meta-analysis of all articles that have been published in medical journals in this area and upheld the argument that I am now putting forward. Now, it seems to me that circumcised men, so far as I'm aware, have never complained of any particular problems, of any particular health problems. And indeed, when I ask people about their medical history, then, in fact, when people give their medical history, when men give their medical history, they never mention circumcision. I only discover it when I come to examine them. People don't remember this as something that has been inflicted upon them. They don't remember it as a medical procedure. They don't consider it as such. Now, sometimes it is true. There are people who have problems in that area, who have sexual problems. Whether or not they have been circumcised, it has nothing to do with circumcision. So I would say, in conclusion, that ritual, cultural, or prophylactic circumcision without any immediate medical benefit is something that's practiced on a very large scale. Indeed, there are advantages that outweigh the disadvantages. But what is sure and certain is that we do need to appropriately regulate the way in which circumcision is practiced. And indeed, the Conference of European Rabbis is organizing recognition of competent practitioners in this area. It is important that circumcision be carried out by doctors or by religious leaders who have expertise in this area recognized by a certificate or diploma. There also needs to be proper information provided to parents. There needs to be agreement. Rules of hygiene need to be respected, and also rules of religious rights need to be respected. All of this is important in order to allow people to deal with the consequences of circumcision. I would say, and this is my last word, that the fundamental rights of parents are crucial here. Parents have to be well informed of what would be in the best interests of their child. And certainly, I think that right has to be recognized as opposed to the right of the children to physical integrity, as, for instance, happens to children in the case of vaccination.
Professor, for your passionate presentation. Now we will give the floor to Assistant Professor Meshrur Shelchuk-Silai, pediatric urologist, Bezmialem Vakif University, Faculty of Medicine, Division of Pediatric Urology from Istanbul, Turkey, representing the Muslim community. And I would like to ask once again all the experts to respect the time, since the time is very limited.
Dear Chairman, dear participants, male circumcision is one of the oldest surgical procedures in history. Approximately, it's not working. One third of the whole men in the world are being circumcised, and the total number estimated is to be 1.2 billion. Of course, those numbers are subject to change, but the reality is that it's being performed in all over the world and in all of the religions and cultures. We all together watched the video about the male circumcision, which is performed in non-sterile conditions. However, the number one rule of the scientific truth is that personal experiences cannot be generalized. How can you adopt this video into 1.2 billion men? Is this fair? Is this scientific? No, it's not. This is a traditional circumcision party in Istanbul. Here you can see the children are very happy wearing fancy clothes and dancing with the traditional Turkish music. But today I'm not going to talk about the personal experiences. Instead, I'm going to talk about the evidence-based medicine. What does the evidence-based medicine say? They only respect the meta-analysis of randomized trials. And all of the examples I'm going to give today are from the meta-analysis. Here we can see that if you are not being circumcised, you have almost 30% chance of having urinary tract infection. It's obvious. If you are not being circumcised, you have a 22-fold of having a penile cancer over your lifetime. It's also been proven. And if you are not circumcised, you have a very higher risk of having sexual transmitted diseases. It's also obvious, and the results are robust. There is also very strong data about AIDS. We also see that up to 66% of protection can be covered by having a male circumcision. Cannot be underestimated. The benefits cannot be underestimated. Did you know that 0.5% of the uncircumcised men require medical attention over their lifetime? Is this a small proportion? Think about it. Does male circumcision adversely affect sexual functions? No, it's not. There are several trials showing that it does not negatively affect. Is it a painful surgery? No, it's not. Under appropriate conditions with local or general anesthesia, it does not cause pain. Is it cost-effective? Yes, it is. Did you know that if you decrease 10% of male circumcisions, you will have a loss of more than 400 euros? So it's also very good for the health communities. So is it affecting the psychological functions? No, it's not. There is no systematic review and meta-analysis on the subject, and the comments are only subjective. American Academy of Pediatrics are commenting on this issue frequently. Let's have a look at it. In 1975, they said that there is no need for routine neonatal circumcision. When we come to 1989, they say that there are potential benefits because the benefits are increased, evidence is increased. In 1999, they say that there is sufficient evidence. And finally, they say that the health benefits of newborn male circumcision outweigh the risks, and they suggest circumcision without any doubt. So what I can say in this evidence, with the growing evidence in favor of male circumcision, we can see that it's very beneficial. I would like to come to the report. It's been said that male circumcision have serious consequences for the health and well-being of the boys. Under those evidence-based medicine, this has been canceled. The male benefits of male circumcision on health is obvious and clear. It's now approved. I'm asking to all of you, are we still going to play three monkeys, or we are going to trust the evidence-based medicine? There are a lot of misleadings and biases of the rapporteur that it's very hard to tell you in this limited time. But the majority of the given references are from non-randomized studies and the low-quality scientific articles or from personal experiences. It's been said that this procedure is increasingly questioned. No, it's not. Instead, there is an increasing evidence on its benefits. It's been said that 100 circumcisions are needed to prevent a single infection. This was true in 2005, but last year an article published, a meta-analysis showed that only 4 circumcisions are needed to prevent one infection. Now I would like to ask you one question. Why are we talking circumcision, but not vaccinations or tonsillectomy? They also have similar complications or more complications than circumcision. But the meta-analysis of tonsillectomy have shown that it has no significant effect on the children's health. But we are talking about circumcision. Does it have a religious context behind? We have to ask this question to ourselves, and we have to be honest. Another error, we can increase all of the errors, but about the HIV infections, it's been said that it's not scientific. I'm showing you this map. In the circled areas, the circumcision is rarely performed. And within the same areas, here you can see that the AIDS prevalence is very high. It's been said that it's the dark side of our own religion. No, it's not. It can only make proud. Again, this video, it's a very bad example, and it cannot be generalized into 1.2 billion circumcision. It's not scientific, and it's not fair. The suggestion of solution was performance of circumcision after 14. There are several risks of doing it. The complication rates are higher, economic costs are higher, protection against UTI and STI are lost or delayed. Most importantly, an adult cannot consent to his own infant circumcision. The time already passed by. An English proverb saying that a stitch in time saves 9. Our suggestion of solution is increasing the standards of circumcision in Europe, encouraging the neonatal circumcision, increasing the awareness in health, and experienced doctors should perform it. I can show the example of Turkey. Now the Turkish Ministry of Health just decided that this procedure can only be performed by medical doctors after next year. Finally, my last slide, we can cheat on ourselves, but we cannot cheat on the scientific truth. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Silaim, for your presentation. And now I would like to give the floor to Dr. Wolfram Hartmann, pediatrician and president of the Professional Federation of Pediatricians and Youth Doctors from Germany, representing said federation. Dr. Hartmann, you have the floor.
Vielen Dank, Herr Vorsitzender.
Thank you very much indeed, Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. I am speaking to you as a representative of the Professional Federation of Pediatricians in Germany, including the Academical Scientific Association of for the prophylactic removal of a young boy's foreskin. That's the first thing. Secondly, claims that such a removal of foreskin provides protection against penile cancer or sexually transmitted diseases, as I say, through the removal of the foreskin, have been refuted in the literature and do not justify the prophylactic removal of foreskin before a young boy is sexually active before the start of puberty. Assertions according to which the removal of the foreskin is a harmless and to a large extent pain-free medical intervention are not attested to in the literature. And pediatric surgeons and doctors who provide follow-on care have been able to document a number of complications. Sensitivity to pain in neonates is also attested to in the literature. Emla cream, which is very often recommended, is not suitable for use on the male genitalia and for local anesthetic purposes in neonates. And under no circumstances can it lead to a pain-free intervention. The fact that when breastfeeding a baby, if the child is given a dummy and is rocked backwards and forwards in its parent's arm is necessarily proof of the fact that that child is not experiencing pain. The high point in terms of post-operative pain in our own experience only occurs circumcised, not only in the internet, but in their own sort of personal statements, have attested to the long-term consequences of circumcision and very often the long-term psychological trauma. Fifthly, effectively informing a child before that child reaches puberty and therefore before it starts any sexual activity as to the possible long-term consequences of complete removal of foreskin and about possible complications inherent in the operation itself and anesthesia is something that is not really possible. And parents cannot simply just consent on their child's behalf, even if they have experienced wise, nor are there objective or tried and tested methods that could be used to ascertain whether a child consents to the intervention. Advocates of circumcision trivialize this form of physical mutilation, which can very often lead to long-term physical or psychological complications, and accusing advocates of the rights of the child or the well-being of the child anti-Semitism and a lack of sensitivity vis-a-vis religions, but I would categorically refute that assertion on behalf of pediatricians. According to the Geneva Declaration, it is stated, I will not permit considerations of age, disease or disability, creed, ethnic origin, gender, nationality, political affiliation, race, my duty and my patient. I will maintain the utmost respect for human life, and I will not use my medical knowledge to violate human rights and civil liberties, even under threat. End of quotation. My eighth point, religious prescriptions should not be able to influence doctors in terms of the treatment that they give their patients, and that is especially the case when talking about young children, minors in other words. Young boys have the same legal claim to physical integrity as girls, and they should not be discriminated against on the grounds of their sex, Article 3 of the Basic Law of the Federal Republic of Germany. The right of parents to bring up their children or religious freedom ends where the physical integrity of a minor unable to give his or her consent is impinged upon. That's Article 2 of the Basic Law of the Federal Republic of Germany. In the absence, that is, of medical indications, as far as we're concerned, it is only symbolic forms of circumcision that don't lead to the shedding of blood in respect of neonates or small children that would be acceptable as a compromise and that we could reconcile with our duty to see to the well-being and the physical integrity of a child. I think a religious education of children, bringing children up on the basis of religious principles, certainly can be reconciled with a form of circumcision that doesn't lead to the shedding of blood. But we have to be able to look at long-standing traditions and rituals from the point of view of our current-day knowledge, and our understanding of man and man's role has changed in various regions of the world. A child is not an object either of his or her parents or religious community, but rather a subject. A child has its own rights. And I think this is a view that a number of Jews and Muslims share, and I would refer you in this context to the letter that Eran Sader, the founder of the Israeli children rights organization Protect the Child, has sent to members of this body. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Hartman. And now I would like to give the floor to Mr. Ronald Goldman, PhD researcher and director of the Circumcision Resource Center from Boston, USA. Mr. Goldman, you have the floor.
Their work on this issue and the opportunity to contribute to this dialogue. I address my comments mostly to the Jewish community. As a Jew and a psychologist, I understand the stress that religious communities feel in connection with questioning of circumcision. I raise such questions with the awareness that they may evoke a range of feelings. I empathize and respect these feelings and also acknowledge the profound place that circumcision has in Judaism. However, I raise these questions out of deep caring and compassion for our community generally and our male infants in particular. We are inflicting generally unrecognized harm with circumcision, and the perpetuation of this harm is far greater a concern than the discomfort that comes from confronting the advisability of this practice. Many Jews who do not circumcise in North America, South America, Europe, and Israel support this view. First, there is the harm to infants. In a comprehensive review of medical literature, investigators concluded newborn infant responses to pain are, quote, similar to but greater than those observed in adult subjects, unquote. This is the reason for numerous studies to find a safe and effective anesthetic for circumcision. There is no such anesthetic. At best, it only temporarily reduces the pain and sometimes does not even do that. Some infants do not cry because they go into shock from the overwhelming pain of the surgery. Researchers found that behavioral changes after circumcision include altered sleep patterns, activity levels and mother-infant interactions, extended crying, and disruptions in feeding and bonding. Infants may also withdraw after circumcision and be unable to communicate their needs. Circumcised newborn infants have increased pain responses 6 months later. This change may represent lasting neurological effects and a symptom of post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. Multiple studies describe the sexual harm. Circumcision removes about a third of the erogenous tissue on the penile shaft, including several kinds of specialized nerves, resulting in thickening and progressive desensitization of exposed erogenous tissue. The adult foreskin is a double layer. Movable sleeve of approximately 75 square centimeters. It protects the penile head, enhances sexual pleasure, and facilitates intercourse. One man compared having sex after an adult circumcision to, quote, seeing in black and white instead of seeing in color, unquote. Research shows that circumcised men are more likely to have erectile dysfunction, orgasm difficulties, and premature ejaculation. They are 4.5 times more likely to use erectile dysfunction drugs. Female partners of circumcised men have more problems with sexual function, fulfillment, and painful intercourse. Several medical societies recognize the long-term psychological effects of circumcision. Based on the collective responses of thousands of men, these effects include anger toward parents and others, sense of loss, shame, fear, distrust, grief, relationship difficulties, depression, sexual anxieties, reduced emotional expression and empathy, low self-esteem, and avoidance of intimacy. Many of these circumcised men wish they had been given a choice at a later time rather than having it forced on them when they were too young to resist. Circumcision is a trauma. For detailed information, I refer you to my book, Circumcision, The Hidden Trauma. Circumcision results in long-term symptoms that fit the pattern of post-traumatic stress disorder, such as avoidance of feelings and stimuli related to the trauma, reduced emotional response, and for some, a tendency to anger. Avoidance symptoms explain why there has been virtually no public discussion of circumcision by those affected. The expressed reasons for circumcision conceal an iceberg of underlying psychological factors. Circumcising a son reenacts the father's unresolved traumatic emotional pain connected with his circumcision and allows the father to avoid confronting this emotional pain. Psychologists note that this compulsion to repeat the trauma is another classic PTSD symptom. It can take the form of a compulsion to generate studies that are intended to show potential, quote, health benefits, unquote, of circumcision, a socially acceptable way to promote circumcision trauma. Of course, by seeking to show only benefits, circumcision advocates do not satisfy their burden to prove that circumcision is harmless. I have outlined some of the harm, and there are at least several dozen additional potential harms that have not been studied. In any case, the physical harm starts the moment an instrument penetrates or clamps a natural, healthy, functioning body part. Some Jewish mothers who observed their son's circumcision remain deeply troubled. Miriam Pollack recalled 15 years after the event, quote, "The screams of my baby remain embedded in my bones and haunt my mind," unquote. Another mother, quote, "My son and I sobbed our hearts out. The circumcision was a horrible violation," unquote. Another mother, quote, "I don't think I can recover from it. We had this beautiful baby boy and seven beautiful days and this beautiful rhythm starting, and it was like something had been shattered," unquote. Mothers risk trauma and PTSD symptoms themselves by observing circumcision. One thing that was shattered was the bond between the mother and child. There are numerous studies that document the harmful behavioral, emotional, neurological, and social effects of disrupted bonding. Close examination of circumcision reveals deep ethical, intellectual, and emotional conflicts among Jewish parents. Repression of these conflicts undermines individual and community integrity. Lisa Braver Moss related her experience, quote, "I had profound doubts about my decision to circumcise, but because open discussion of Brit Milah seems to be discouraged in the Jewish community, I experienced my doubts privately and without comfort. Thus, a rite intended to inspire feelings of Jewish unity evoked in me a sense of loss and alienation," unquote. Parents who feel forced into making a decision that conflicts with their better instincts may harbor feelings of resentment against the community and tradition to which they feel compelled to conform. Muslims generally circumcise older children. A study of such circumcisions showed that circumcision is perceived by the child as an aggressive attack upon his body, which damaged and mutilated him. Circumcision resulted in increased aggressive the procedure. A few weeks later, parents reported that the children exhibited increased aggressive behavior and experienced fears and nightmares. These are PTSD symptoms. A shocked and regretful Jewish mother said, quote, "I didn't know how horrific it was going to be," unquote. The widespread lack of knowledge about circumcision results from avoiding and denying basic circumcision information about harm. It serves to protect adults from discomfort while increasing the risk that children will be circumcised. One more moment. We need increased awareness, education, and open, respectful debate. If parents are going to make decisions about circumcision for their sons, Such decisions should be informed and based on complete information. I also recommend psychological support for children and adults. To those who may be voting on this issue, please vote on the merits and your conscience. Future generations of children are depending on you to do the right thing.
Thank you, Mr. Goldman. Now I open the floor for discussion. Please understand that, as I explained earlier, there was a speaker list made, and at the end I will reserve a few minutes time for questions from journalists. And yeah, I'd like to remind you that the time limit is 2 minutes for each speaker. So the first speaker is the former chair of the Social Affairs Committee, Ms. Liliane Maury-Pasquier from Switzerland.
Thank you, Chair. Ladies and gentlemen, might I that have been anti-Semitic, that it stoked anti-Semitism and hatred and other things. Now, I think these reproaches are completely unfounded. I'd like the current chair of this, I would say that the process that has led to this draft resolution was conducted according to all the rules, after hearings, after different decision, but also about all other aspects of limits to the well-being of children. Now, there are many other aspects we also deal with, where there are difficulties and matters affecting the rights of children. We also deal with all of those to defend the rights of children. I'd also like to respond to the reproach made against the chair of the committee, because it seemed to me that there was also criticism directed at that, saying that I should leave. I can tell you I'm no longer chair, be reassured, but I didn't leave because of that reproach, but simply because we do rotate. And so my term in office came to an end. So in this matter, like anything else, I'd like to point out that I try always to show complete neutrality in my work in the committee. Let me also state briefly, I've already said, so I'd like to repeat that the rights of children, the rights of the child, are human rights. They're not half people. They have complete equal rights. Now, of course, there are some rights, several rights concerned here, several principles, the fundamental rights of parents to be appropriately informed so that they can achieve an informed opinion about what to do, freedom of religion and conscience, the rights of children, rights to physical integrity in line with the human rights as enshrined by the UN, and the rights of children to be involved in all decisions affecting them. Of course, there are conflicting rights, and when these exist, there must be dialogue on a matter which is exceedingly sensitive, I admit. Dialogue, we need to think about our own practices without prejudice and without any rejection, and if possible, since I'm now, every day I have to cross the room to go to my ranks, and I go past my Israeli colleagues, if possible, without any hatred. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Maury-Pasquier. The next speaker is Mr. Shai from Israel. Is Mr. Shai here from Israel? Yeah, you are the next speaker.
Do you hear me? I presented earlier a documentary that we produced last week in Israel, where we clearly and obviously show evidence by a number of Israeli MDs. By the name, not all of them are Jewish. One was Muslim and the other was a Christian. So they represent, I would say, the entire Israeli people, and not necessarily Israeli people, but as we heard from the respected Turkish professor, also Muslims living in Israel and Christians too, that those who live in Nazareth prefer to perform circumcision in high percentage. Mr. Chairperson, believe that this issue shouldn't even come to this forum, not that we disrespect it, not at all. We respect the Council of Europe very much, but we believe that it in principle deals with the freedom of religious, which is very dear to us, which we have been doing for generations ago. That's part of our history, that's part of our tradition, and we believe in it. We just say, there'll be other speakers following me, that it should be done in a proper way, should be done by experts, should be done by people that were authorized and given the right direction and the right guidance, and so there'll be no harm for infants and babies whatsoever. We followed it very carefully. It's been done in Israel this way, and I believe in the entire Jewish world. And if you ask me, I believe it should be removed from this table and won't come back. We are launching a counter initiative now in the European in the Parliamentary Assembly. We are intending to reverse this resolution because we believe that it shouldn't be done from the very beginning, and even now it's not too late. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Schein. Now I would like to give the floor to Mr. Ilhan Kouri from Morocco.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Chair. Ladies and gentlemen, parliamentarians, allow me to take the floor on this important issue. I have some comments I'd like to make. Firstly, I'd like to commend the fact that this discussion is being organized and the way it's being conducted. We've had a democratic discussion. We've seen one film showing good things about circumcision, one against, and we've also heard from eminent professors, again for and against. There's one point I'd like to make strongly at the outset. Here we seem to have a confusion between circumcision and excision. Excision is something that has nothing to do with religion, whereas circumcision is something different. Excision is something that is done in a way that is not medical, whereas circumcision is carried out medically. Excision is something that is contested by all of those who have suffered it. And again, that is far from the case with circumcision. And in medical terms, coming back again to the film showed us the complications that can arise from circumcision. Circumcision is a medical intervention, and like any medical intervention, there can be complications. And I'm sure that when there were complications, then the procedures were not carried out by extremely expert people. I'm not 100% sure of that, but it would seem to me to be the case. There's a question I'd like to put to the eminent professors who've spoken to us here today. In the course of your work, have you had any complaints from circumcised adults? Particularly with reference to psychological and sexual effects caused by circumcision. Because previously we know that a claim was made that circumcised males complained of sexual problems. And certainly, as a Muslim and as a doctor, I would state the contrary. Thank you.
What I would like to remind our experts that at the end you'll have 2 minutes. If there are questions addressed to you, you can answer those questions. Now we will move the speaker list for the members of the Assembly, and I am going to give the floor to Ms. Kyriakidis, the General Rapporteur on Children from Cyprus.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Now, as Rapporteur for the Child of the Council of Europe and as a member of the Health and Social Affairs Committee, I feel that we need to take a position in this meeting that is not confrontational, but that is child-centered. Professor Lobo. ...of Europe, as we all know, is to respect and promote human rights. And part of these rights include children's rights. And this also includes religious freedom. Children's rights, I don't believe, should have different camps. And I believe that all of us in this room, if we are asked, promote and support the rights of children, and this needs to be the basis of this discussion. We're here to have a dialogue, and we're here to discuss if we can bridge actually the gaps between the rights of children and the realities of children in Europe. I personally want to congratulate Madame Ruprecht, because only a very strong advocate of children's rights would have undertaken such a very difficult and challenging subject. I think what we need to look at and what she has proposed in her report is that we are discussing whether this as a practice is a violation of a child's physical integrity. This is the question. We're not here to judge or criticize religious freedom. But what we are saying is that the violation of a child's physical integrity is the question that is raised, and we need to put all practices that violate children's physical integrity under that. This is not a question of the rights of parents, it's a question of the rights of children. And I fully support the report that has come out of our committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kyriakides. Now I give the floor to Ms. Fataliyeva from Azerbaijan.
Ladies and gentlemen, I come from a Muslim country. That's why my position is quite obvious. We have heard much about medical instructions for this procedure, and I completely agree with that idea that the procedure should be regarded only as medical. A child never chooses himself whether to keep or to remove adenoid, or to do or not to do a tonsillectomy. And we were discussing here the borders of children's rights. We are in the Council of Europe, where our most important task is to fight for freedom of speech, for freedom of expression, and freedom of religion. And I think that it is most important here in this question to determine the borders of freedom of religion. Today we have this resolution. Maybe tomorrow we will have another resolution which says that fasting is also a violation of human rights or something like this. None of the resolution would never change any tradition of religion. 47 countries are represented in this organization. This organization is based on respect to each other nations. And I call you to do this, because otherwise we couldn't make a dialogue between each other. We should respect each other's values. This is much more important.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Fataliyeva. Please understand me correctly. I have nothing against applauses, but it's our time. So if you want to save them for the sake of time, I think it will be good. So the next speaker is Mr. Ciocchi from Italy.
Sì, grazie.
Thank you, Chairman. Well, I would like to draw attention to an issue that hasn't been given much of an airing during this discussion and in the interventions from colleagues. And it's not an issue that concerns just Israel or countries where there's a Muslim majority, but rather we're talking about something that concerns millions of European citizens of differing religions. Those are Jewish and Muslim alike. And possibly we should have brought more sensitivity to these issues, because we're talking about citizenship rights. We're talking about something that concerns millions of Europeans, as is my case. Religion is not that of the Jewish or Muslim faiths. We shouldn't forget cultures that differ from the mainstream culture also. And I think a lot of citizens feel that their existence is being threatened, or the right to freedom of religious belief. I've listened with much attention to the discussion or the debate between scientists, all of the different opinions, the National Bioethics Council in Italy, for example, or other august and esteemed bodies who said that circumcision really isn't harmful, nor does it impinge upon the psychological or physical integrity of a child. So I think we have a difference of opinions, but I think we're seeing legitimacy of circumcision being called into question, and I think to uphold the right to freedom it's not true that circumcision is necessarily carried out later. It is suggested that circumcision on Muslim boys be carried out within the first few days, if not the first few months, of the life of a child. So I disagree what was said on that score by a pediatrician. Sort of scientific evidence that attests to post-traumatic sort of stress disorders, but I think that is not attested to widely in the literature.
Thank you. Thank you. And now the last speaker on the speaker list for PASE members is Mr. Richard from France.
Yes, thank you, Chair. We've heard two experts in favor of circumcision and two experts against circumcision. Now, as a member of the Parliamentary Assembly, a non-expert, it's difficult for me to express an opinion on this work, because if we're going to choose, we need to choose necessarily good experts. Now, I find it very shocking that we put on an equal footing such differing gestures as circumcision, piercing, excision, as Mrs. Rupert, the rapporteur, said just a moment ago. You said that the decision that had been taken following your report was a moderate decision, if only for that, the fact that we seemed to consider as synonymous these things which are so different seems to me very mistaken. For my part, I have to say that independently of what you might say about whether a circumcision is painful, whether it constitutes mutilation for me, religious circumcision is an inherent gest. It's part of a bigger whole, part of a religious identity, Jewish or Muslim identity. And in the moment when you respect religious identity, and I think this is the case, then you have necessarily to respect the identity of that religion, including all of the gestures which are part of it.
Thank you, and thanks to all members of the Assembly who expressed their views. And now we will move to our guest. And the first on my list is Mr. Victor Schoenfeld, the producer of the first documentary film. Please, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you. Israeli Knesset member Shai, in his remarks at the film showing, said, Israel will reject with all our might and force any attempt to stop circumcision. That's a near quote. I think it's very revealing, because circumcision of children is enforced on children. That's what's objectionable about it. If the claims of health benefits that the Israeli doctors in the propaganda film made are so persuasive, then young men across Europe would be choosing to be circumcised. They are not. Doctors' associations across Europe say routine circumcision is not justified. The harm caused by circumcision is undeniable. That's why it's done to children, because they cannot object. We can get away with doing it to them by the use of force. The Israeli documentary denies babies feel pain. This is a blatant piece of falsehood and discredits any claims of medical benefits in that film. Ostracized. There's a young mother in Tel Aviv right now who is being faced with daily court fines for refusing to have her son circumcised. This speaks volumes about the arrogance attached to the custom of circumcision. Thank you.
Thank you. And the next speaker is Mr. Gutmann, a rabbi of Strasbourg.
Me voici. Vous avez devant vous un fils de ce peuple.
I stand before you, a son of the nation which has been denounced because of its faithfulness to the tradition of circumcision and accused of having a dark side. Now, we are, of course, concerned about what we see going on today because for the first time since the Shoah, we see that the finger is being pointed at us in Europe, even here in the very heart of Europe. And Europe has to be able to discuss and dialogue with itself and with other cultures without stigmatizing the other in any way, because that could imperil our common home.
We see that there is a recurrence of the suspicion, and this means that we need to find a kind of scapegoat, a mythical cause, and what would be better than that, the ritual crime, the ritual of circumcision? Who could exclude the risk because the fact that the Jew could be stigmatized as the source of all evils, as the cause of teaching from Boston to teach us European Jews, Jews from Berlin, European Jews who've been here for thousands of years, what Jewish generate ourselves, and with an English film which goes far too far. No vote can put asunder those elements which, since the Bible, since Abraham, have been created for indissoluble links and which will create us what we are and what we will always be. The struggle of Jews has continued for many centuries. Mrs. Ubrecht, you're talking about physical integrity. This was something which did not escape the fathers of Europe, because they were talking about the spiritual heritage and building Europe together. History, and we are witnesses to history, and Europe is a land of freedom, and which we cannot undermine. Thank you.
I call the next speaker, and sorry if I mispronounce your surnames. Mr. Christian Bachels, or Bachels Association of Bals, Association of Children Affected by Violence Against Their Physical Integrity, from Germany.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Christian Bals. I address you as chairperson of MOGUS e.V., an association of people affected by acts against their sexual self-determination, including sexual abuse, sexualized violence, and non-therapeutic genital surgeries. As a trauma victim myself, I am deeply sympathetic to people who feel troubled and anxious that this debate takes place at all. But I would like to ask you to allow this debate to take place, the debate about the legitimacy of non-therapeutic foreskin amputation, the so-called circumcision, that this debate can take place. Today, I represent those of our members who have been negatively affected by foreskin amputations in their childhood. Those men perceive their circumcision as a mutilation. They feel their voice being neglected, and many of them feel abused. Just Friday, I was at a meeting of a network of associations working against female genital mutilation in Germany, Europe, and in Africa. Some of the African members told me that he has evidence, pictures, and reports that male circumcision in its consequences can be as bad as female genital mutilation, even the one which is called infibulations. There are male circumcisions which have very bad effects on the males. Of course, men negatively affected by circumcision will not report negative effects to a pro-circumcision urologist. They just do not want to be laughed at. For those men, the debate about circumcision is not a debate about issues of religious freedom, but the issue of sexual self-determination and the right to an open future. Yes, 30% of men probably are circumcised, but most of them did not consent into it. It must be stated that circumcision has been done for many reasons. The medicalization of the debate is a new phenomenon. In the past, foreskin amputations have been proposed as a cure against masturbation and hysteria, and now it is being proposed against HIV and other diseases where actually the evidence is very slim, inconclusive, and also might entail a higher risk of contracting HIV if being circumcised. Thank you very much. I stop here.
Thank you, Mr. Balls. And now I would like to give the floor to Mr. El Helloui, President of Grand Mosque of Strasbourg.
In 2 minutes, there's a risk of being interrupted, like my colleague, the Chief Rabbi of Strasbourg, but it's sad to see just how a simple matter is dealt with in this film that we saw before this meeting. Whereas we know that in the extreme majority of, the vast majority of cases, it's a minor surgical intervention done under anesthesia by skilled, acknowledged surgeons. Circumcision in Islam is a religious tenet. And I think there is a right to religion. Europe guarantees this. This practice is no more dramatic than cutting the umbilical cord of a newborn baby. I mean, we cut other parts out. We cut our nails and our hair for hygienic reasons. Now, of course, medical errors are committed. They may be due to all sorts of factors, but be that as it may, you have an example, I think, in your own lives. Can talk about that. We know what we're talking about. But legislating against circumcision would bring us back, I think, to perpetuate tradition of existing in secrecy, an underground existence, whereas we should preserve the rights of the child. Now, at the moment when South Africa, a major country where there's neither Islam nor Christianity is a major religion, nor the Jewish faith, there they recommend circumcision as being good for health. So it seems strange, but sometimes it seems that we go too far for completely unnecessary reasons.
Thank you. And now the next speaker is Miss Brigitte Kahn, Association Regard d'Enfant from France.
Ladies and gentlemen, members of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, you have committed yourselves to promote democracy in accordance with the European Human Rights Convention. And therefore, perhaps allow us to put four questions to you on the subject of this mission, which can only honor you. We had rather sort of a partial or prejudiced, a shocking film leading into this meeting. You, in so doing, promoting democracy. We had about circumcision from the point of view of health. Health benefits. They have been attested to, but in so saying, you're contributing to promoting democracy. And if you don't denounce the stigmatization of sectors in the population in the light of their religious convictions, in so doing, are you promoting peace and democracy in Europe? And in not denouncing today the risk of legislation that would lead to the gradual disappearance of certain religions and calling into question what are the fundamental tenets of the transmission of religion down the generations and that for millennia, in so doing, are you promoting democracy in Europe? Ladies and gentlemen, members of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, at the end of the year 2013, European democracy lost a battle with the adoption of a resolution that seeks to as a pillar of democracy, and you will help us win the war over those who seek to trample democracy underfoot.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Khan. And now I give the floor to Mr. Moshe Levin, Executive Director of European Conference of Rabbis.
L'audition de ce jour se déroule dans la même session.
This afternoon's hearing is taking place during the same session as the session in which we're going to hear the danger expressed on, as to the increase in anti-Semitism in Europe today. And we know that this step, which is calling into question one of the fundamental precepts of Judaism for millennia, can only further serve to stigmatize a people which, in accordance with the European Convention on Human Rights, wishes only to peacefully exercise their right to freedom of religion. And this hearing is also taking place actually happened on the 1st of October, and at that time not one religious expert had been heard prior to the preparation of that report. And in fact, a third of the members of the Assembly were not even present when the report was adopted. Allow me then to doubt just how sincere the whole procedure was. The supposed arguments were those in favor of child protection, but today, at this hearing, we can note the different views that have been expressed by experts. And I'm talking about experts, not activists. We've noted that the experts were those who took a particular view today, and we have to look at where they came from. And we know that, in fact, Germany is a country which has actually now prevented certain experts from taking the view that they ought to be able to make. And in fact, Mr. Hartmann has been able to try to convince the Assembly here of something that he hasn't fully been able to convince his own country of. Are we going to allow that? No. Unless we continue to allow circumcision in Europe to be practiced as it is today, it will not be possible. To ask you to hear what we are saying, to ask you to go back and look again at the resolution, to be aware of the seriousness of the message you are sending out to so many people, because you are talking about circumcision as mutilation, and think what that is saying to the hundreds of thousands of people in the world today who are listening to you.
Thank you. And now the next speaker is Mr. Sinden Droit au Corps from France.
Monsieur le Président.
Chair,
I'm
exceedingly shocked as a Franco-German citizen because of the warlike vocabulary being used when it comes to a resolution, which I thought was very moderate, only claims one thing, that is, we want to raise the question about circumcision and debate it. It doesn't ask for anything more. It wasn't, nobody called for to ban circumcision, we simply wish to have a calm debate. That was all. Thank you.
Thank you. And now I call Mr. Philippe Carmel, European Jewish Congress.
Thank you. I want to thank Mrs. Lubrecht for convening us all here. And I want to express my shock at the fact that they had a vote and they had a report and they had a debate without inviting experts for more than 6 months, and in fact for more than a year. And that we have the opportunity here to hear eminent urologists and eminent religious representatives who should have been part of the debate a long, long, long time ago, because we would have never reached this situation where Jewish communities and Muslim communities are watching all over Europe as initiatives are taken in Scandinavia and in other places to really ban circumcision. That started here. That process, that initiative to instill fear in our communities began in this chamber, in this Conseil de l'Europe, which was set up to defend the fundamental rights of minorities, to make sure that the situation that occurred 70 years ago on this continent does not happen again, that people fear persecution. I want to say that I'm shocked. I'm really shocked of the amalgam that has been made here between male circumcision and female genital mutilation. And I want to tell Madame Luprecht that if she really wants to fight to make sure that female genital mutilation is swept away from this continent and indeed from the world, she should not trivialise it or to banalise it by mixing it up with all sorts of issues which have absolutely nothing to do with it. She does not serve the purpose of religious rights. She does not serve the purpose of minority rights. She does not serve the purpose of children's rights. And she does not serve the purpose of women's rights. That is a position of all the Jewish communities in Europe. I represent here the European Jewish Congress. We have 42 member communities, democratically elected, throughout Europe, religious, secular, left, right, men, women, and children. If those Jewish communities are to remain on this continent, then their religious rights and their cultural rights require protection, and this is the body that should protect them. Thank you.
Thank you. And now I give the floor to Mr. Harald Winterling from Germany, I don't pronounce probably correctly the name of your organization, but Mr. Winterling from Germany.
Thank you, Mr. President. It is interactive, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, parliamentarians, for listening to me. I would like to comment on some things that have already been said here and some things we have seen in the films. I'd like to point out that the harm that we saw in the first film where a young boy was circumcised in England showed us only a tiny little part of the harm done, necessarily done, by any circumcision. The real harm is in adult life. And I'm very aware of the fact that many people are reluctant to speak about what was being done to them. Some cannot speak for decades, some cannot speak the whole life, but victims are among us, and victims are speaking up. We are seeing the tip of an iceberg there, and there is really 99.9% of the harm in adult life, and the loss and sexual feeling and what is removed from a perfectly functioning body. That's the first point I'd like to make. The second point we saw in the second film and in some testimonies from professors in the front, we saw claims made about the perceived benefits of circumcision. I'm quite sure that the very people who told us these things are aware that those claims are utterly wrong and that they are proven wrong. However, they keep repeating that, sorry for the word, the same utter nonsense that have been proven wrong. Then I'd like to come back to the point made right now that we've heard genital mutilation of males and females together with piercings and things like that. Of course, the divisory line should be between piercings and genital mutilation of either males or females. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Winterling. And now the last speaker, I have to interrupt the list of speakers because of time, is Madame Manuelle Amar, European Council of Wiso Federations from France.
Oui, bonjour.
Yes, good afternoon. I'm a surgeon, and I've operated on, I've performed about 5,500 circumcisions in Mulhouse. First of all, let me make two brief comments. There's a lady who's spoken about the rights of the child. Let me say that we need also to integrate the idea of helping children profit from their one's own experience. If the parents consider that a circumcised man will have fewer problems, many fewer, then he'll be able, they're enabling their children to profit from experiences they've had themselves. Then a lady said that the preparation of this text had been very balanced. I'm sorry, but I don't think it was balanced at all. It was done rather without Jews and Muslims. It was done by experts who proved not to be anything of the kind. It was done by a pediatrician and a psychologist. Well, I would like to put a question. Can you be an expert in coronary surgery if you're not actually a coronary surgeon? So I must say I reject these two so-called experts because they seem very clearly to belong to the anti-circumcision wave. And it seems that at none of these hearings have we really heard from a true pro-circumcision expert. Let me just continue a little, if I may. I'd like to talk about my own experience. So I've performed more than 5,500 circumcisions, 5,000 in clinics, and maybe 500 in my surgery. Now, these circumcisions are done under a general anesthetic. There's also a local anesthetic, so when the child wakes up, they don't suffer pain. So for 2 to 3 hours, we're sure that such cannot occur. Just two words. I've never been aware of any complications, and I don't say so to show off. And I've never had anyone come back to complain.
Now, I already announced that I will interrupt the list of speakers. The secretariat draw my attention that we need to keep a balance, so there'll be one more speaker. This will be the last speaker on our guest list. It's going to be Dr. Matthias Schreiber, from a pediatric surgeon from Germany.
Vielen Dank. Ja, ich bin
Kinderchirurg. Thank you. Yes, I'm a neurologist, child neurologist, and a pediatrician. I really have to contest it when it says that circumcision leads to virtually no complications. I would refute that almost every week I see children. In a child neurology sort of unit in a university hospital. I mean, I don't think we should sort of flag up freedom of religion because a lot of these operations carried out on children no given religion.
We have a couple of minutes for press. If there are journalists here wishing to address questions, now it's your time, and after this, we'll let our experts to express their final conclusion. So I see nobody interested from the press. Then we will go to our experts list, and we will do the other way around. The first speaker will be Mr. Goldman from United States.
Thank you. I'd like to quote a brief section from my book, Questioning Circumcision, the Jewish Perspective. The central purpose of Judaism is tikkun olam, the repair and healing of the world. Much of the pain of the world is the result of repeating old harmful patterns of behavior. By breaking a chain of pain, foregoing circumcision contributes to our healing. As we heal from this pain, we will be better able to heal others and reach our ethical and spiritual potential. New information, reasoned inquiry, gut feelings, personal experience, and Jewish ethical values together make a strong case for keeping a male infant the way he is born, natural and whole. I hope we continue this debate with compassion and respect for the children.
Thank you. And now, Dr. Hartmann.
Vielen Dank.
Thank you very much. Well, unfortunately, I note that a matter-of-fact debate has not been possible. I feel that I've been attacked personally. I should like to point out that I have worked as a pediatric specialist and surgeon for 32 years. I think it's really unbearable to be attacked like this. I was invited here as an expert. I'm not here because I wished to be here, but rather because I was asked to come. And it's customary in Germany as well. It's customary that we change aspects, customs of Christianity if they're no longer up to date. That's possible within a religion. And we've said this to many friends who are Muslims and Jews, and I must say I've received a lot of correspondence of people who think likewise when it comes to medical indication. There are no European guidelines about prophylactic removal of the foreskin on medical grounds. So once again, I'd ask you please to keep things here matter of fact, and I feel that I've been attacked when we're told that we have been anti-Semitic, when we simply express a differing opinion. We receive many young Jewish and Muslim children, so it's difficult for me to understand just where this criticism comes from. I can tell you I know from Jewish friends in Germany who've said to me that there are more uncircumcised men, Jewish men living in Germany than circumcised Jewish men. And it's obvious to me that they can live perfectly happily like then. So let's try and keep things orderly and matter of fact. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hartmann. And now Professor Silay from Turkey.
Thank you very much. As a pediatric urologist, what I can say in my conclusion is that I believe every people in this room are willing to help the children. And if you are really willing to do it, please stop the discussion of if the circumcision should be done or not, because it's not scientific. The evidence is obvious and clear. But instead, let's all come together and discuss how to improve the standards of the performance, to do the appropriate analgesia, anesthesia, and those are the things that we need to discuss, and please, let the people live their religions on their own way. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Silay. And now I would like to give the microphone to Professor Lobel.
Well, just to draw this discussion to a conclusion, I would merely like to make the following statement. Sometimes in surgery, you think, and the more that you think about it, the better it is. You're always trying to improve the way that you operate, and you're always trying to ensure that people are better informed. And here we have to make sure that parents are well informed, less so children when they're very young. I would just like to respond to two specific questions. One came from our colleague from Morocco, who asked, an article was published that gives a meta-analysis of the problem and really shows what the actual situation is. A second question was about pain. It is true that we are talking about a sensitive area, that the foreskin can be sensitive. However, when we think about the way in which pain can be remembered, certainly the evidence or the claim that that pain is remembered is not convincing.
And now the last conclusion will be presented by the rapporteur, Ms. Ruprecht.
Vielen Dank, Herr Vorsitzender.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Very briefly, It's been said that we have taken a decision and that wasn't preceded by any discussion, but everybody has been invited along. Experts, representatives of different religions have been invited to participate. But when talking about children and their rights, well, in any debate, it is the rights of the child that are foremost in our minds. Because children very often are not being taken seriously and they're being manipulated for the purposes of political debates. We have had a very sort of open-ended debate within the committee, as the Rapporteur General has said. This has been an open process. We have clearly stated posited the terms of the debate quite clearly. And we have certainly never laid claim to being medical practitioners ourselves, and we're certainly not interested in denouncing religions, forbidding religions. We're talking about the rights of the child. And if you look at Article 9 of the Human Rights Convention, read that article through right to the end, it is said that religious freedom finds its limits where it impinges on the rights of others, and amongst those others we have to include children. And there are only two countries that haven't signed up to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, signed up to and ratified that convention. And I think children had to be consulted in any major decisions that will have an impact on their lives. And if you cannot consult a child because it is too young, you have to wait until that child can be consulted. That, I think, is our claim. I don't think there's any way of getting around that. Although our debate has been somewhat controversial, I have met with a number of people from Israel, and when speaking to someone from these intelligence services, when asked how can we come to an agreement, and he said, well, speak or debate these issues. I think that's the only way of getting round difficulties, is entering into a dialogue, a discussion. You have to reflect upon your own position when entering into a debate or discussion with others. This is certainly something I attempt to do, and I would recommend that others attempt to do it also. And my last appeal, I have worked together with children, disadvantaged children, over decades, and when advocating a measure, I've always asked myself, well, what if I were in the shoes of that child, or if this was my child, what would I do? So I think what we need is to bring a certain amount of empathy to this debate. So I would ask you to try and understand what motivates us in wanting to put children at the heart of the debate. There are no sort of covert racist motives that we can be accused of. No, as far as we're concerned, it's the right of the child, or the rights of the child, that are uppermost in our minds. And I think if we could come to an agreement on that, I would be most grateful. And hopefully we can grapple our way forward to some kind of common future.
Thank you, Mr. Ruprecht. Well, I'm glad that we have been able to reach the end of this meeting peacefully. And I want to thank you for a lively debate. Opinions were very passionate and polarized. But I think it's important to make one more point. Dear guests and members of the Assembly, today the aim of this meeting was not to discuss any draft resolution. So I regret that it was a kind of misunderstanding that today this meeting was organized after the special day yesterday. The aim of this meeting was to continue a dialogue. The resolution has been already passed. Now we want to continue the dialogue. So let me tell you that at this moment there will be no follow-up on this issue until the Assembly receives the reply from the Committee of Ministers on this recommendation. So we are open to have a dialogue in the future. But at this point, again, the resolution has been passed. I believe it has been good to listen to to different opinions, although there has been an hearing in 2013 organized, and I regret that some of you didn't have a chance to attend that hearing. Nevertheless, again, once again, I would like to thank everybody and to thank also the interpreters for their flexibility in allowing us to continue longer than has been played. And I wish you a good day here in Strasbourg. And if some of you didn't have a chance to speak, you can meet and bilaterally discuss your views. I wish you a good day, and I declare the meeting closed.